So while we are all waiting for Starship SN8 to complete its 12.5 km test flight, let's talk about some other interesting stuff meanwhile. For example, Jeff Bezos seems quite confident that the first woman on the moon will be brought there with a Blue Origin moon lander. And China is working on their own moon rocket, the Long March 9. Regarding NASA, the White House asks Congress to remove the Europa Clipper SLS requirement.
Then at Roscosmos, a lot of commotion seems to be going on with a lot of high-ranking officials being fired or imprisoned or both. So what the hell is going on there? And now that the Arecibo telescope has completely collapsed, will a new larger one take its place? And the collected samples from the asteroid Ryugu have returned to Earth. A lot to talk about, so stay tuned. Now that the first high-altitude test flight of Starship could take place basically any time, it probably makes sense to use the time and talk a bit more about other topics. And how cool is it that Jeff Bezos himself gives us some nice material to get over the waiting time? This is the engine that will take the first woman to the surface of the moon, he wrote last Friday in an Instagram post. In that same Instagram post, a video is included where you can see the Blue Origin BE-7 engine firing up in a test. So Jeff Bezos seems really confident that it will be Blue Origin, or more precisely the national team, that will land the next astronauts on the moon.
We are not so sure about that. First, the whole Artemis program will get pushed back under a new administration, and the 2024 moon landing date will not hold. Most likely, it will become 2028. Therefore, the three moon landers, which are currently being funded by NASA to return astronauts to the moon, including the aforementioned national team lander, Dynetics' Apaka lander, and of course SpaceX's gargantuan Starship, will not get a lot of funding from NASA in the next years. NASA requested $3.5 billion for the fiscal year 2021. In order to continue working on the moon landers. But now, NASA only got $1 billion. And this trend will continue. Hence, NASA will not have enough funds to support the development of three moon landers simultaneously. Instead, they will probably have to choose one contender. Jeff Bezos seems to be quite confident that it will be his moon lander. And of course, it's clear why. Because he allied himself with Lockheed, Northrop, and Draper to form the national team, the first two basically being the old guard of human spaceflight. And you know that US Congress loves those companies, as they spend quite some money on lobbying. Furthermore, Bezos also knows that NASA loves non-innovative approaches. The national team lander is by far the most conservative approach to land on the moon. It makes Dynetics' moon lander, the Apaka, seem insanely innovative by comparison. And we don't even have to talk about Starship. So yes, Jeff Bezos does have good reasons to believe that his company, Blue Origin, will be chosen to build the human landing system for the Artemis program.
But if we look at it from a purely economical perspective, NASA would be very smart to fully support only SpaceX with Starship. Not only is it far bigger, has a lot more interior volume, and is a lot more capable than the Lobby moon lander, but it will be also by far the cheapest option. But even should NASA really decide to go with the national team, we are pretty sure that SpaceX will then simply land on the moon on their own without NASA. Probably in that case even way before 2028. Which would be quite the hilarious twist of events if you ask us.
And please subscribe to our YouTube channel, because we are the only space channel that openly talks about lobbyism and corruption in the space industry. This is of course a very controversial topic, so we really need your support in order to make an impact. Thank you so much in advance. Meanwhile, we have some interesting reports from China regarding their human moon landing ambitions. Only in September, China gave an update on their moon landing infrastructure, about which we talked in this video here. They want to use a new rocket, which looks quite similar to the Falcon Heavy. But contrary to Falcon Heavy, it will be non-reusable. The required deep space capsule they do already have, and even already tested it. In some flights, they also showed the complete moon landing and return procedure with their own moon lander. But now, Xu Hongliang, Secretary General of the China National Space Administration, gave an update at the Wenchang International Aerospace Forum on November 24th. And here, sadly, the focus was again the Long March 9, China's super heavy lift rocket, which is apparently still in development. We thought that the development on Long March 9 had been abandoned in favor of the new moon rocket. But apparently, China is simultaneously developing two moon rockets.
While the new unnamed Chinese moon rocket will be slightly less capable than the Falcon Heavy, the Long March 9 will be a total beast. Basically a Chinese Saturn V, if you will. It will have the same 140 metric tons to LEO payload capacity as the Saturn V and a slightly higher 50 metric tons to translunar injection orbit. So what do we make of this info? Why is China developing two moon rockets simultaneously? Well, there is probably a good reason for that. For landing the moon lander itself with the astronauts on the moon, China will use the new, less capable moon rocket. For delivering larger payloads such as power systems, propellant plants, and habitation modules, China will use the large Long March 9. That way, they can simultaneously land astronauts on the moon while at the same time already build a moon base. We think that they understand the strategic importance of the moon and they will immediately start building a moon base after they have landed their taikonauts on the moon. According to current time plans, this will probably be around the year 2030. So it now is up to Elon to return humans to the moon before that. Because if we rely on NASA and the government to build us that moon base, you know what will happen. We've been waiting since 1972 for that, and not much has happened since. Elon Musk and SpaceX are the only ones who can probably build a moon base before China. That being said, we are still quite impressed by China's slow and steady approach. It becomes more and more clear how China's long-term human moon habitation strategy looks, and it becomes more and more clear that they are really intent on achieving their moon plans.
In other news, the White House is asking Congress to remove a passage from an appropriations bill that would direct NASA to launch the Europa Clipper mission on the SLS rocket. The chairman of the Senate Appropriations Committee, Russell Wout, addressed Republican Senator Richard Shelby from Alabama in a letter. He wrote to Shelby, "The administration is disappointed that the bill would require NASA to use the Space Launch System rocket to launch the Europa Clipper mission. This would increase costs for the Clipper mission and deprive the lunar exploration effort of a rocket NASA needs for human exploration of the moon. The Europa Clipper is a probe that is currently scheduled to be sent to Jupiter's icy moon Europa in 2024. It's not that the probe is insanely heavy and needs to be launched by SLS. In fact, SpaceX's Falcon Heavy would totally suffice to launch the spacecraft, a scenario that NASA has been favoring more and more in the last years, thanks in large part to Jim Bridenstine. But of course, that would mean less orders for SLS. And since you know that SLS is in large parts being built in Alabama, and Senator Shelby is from Alabama, it's no wonder that Shelby is very insistent that the Europa Clipper should be launched on an SLS. Here we really hope that reason will prevail, because a Falcon Heavy launch will reduce the costs of the mission by about $1 billion.
At Roscosmos, meanwhile, a lot of commotion seems to be going on. Only 2 weeks ago, Andrei Oklopkov, the leader of the Center for Exploitation of Ground-Based Space Infrastructure, who administered all of Russia's spaceports, has been fired by Dmitry Rogozin, the chief of Roscosmos himself. Not long before that, Rogozin also fired Vladimir Zhuk, chief engineer of the center that administers Russian spaceports. Both people who were fired were working to bring Russia's new Vostochny spaceport to full capacity. Several other key officials had also been arrested or fired or both. The construction of the spaceport has been riven with corruption, often through embezzlement, and overall cost estimates of the facility have increased to more than $7.5 billion. Of the planned 7 launch pads, only one is operational. Russia's President Putin is critical of the constant cost overruns and delays at the Vostochny spaceport. Until now, Rogozin still somehow managed to blame others, but we don't know for how long he can continue to do that. Because Rogozin himself is suspected to engage quite heavily in corrupt activities, as some Russian sources claim, citing his over-the-top luxurious lifestyle, where it's not quite clear where all that money comes from. So let's see how long Rogozin will manage to stay leader of Roscosmos. Because if Roscosmos had a capable leader who would really be interested and enthusiastic about spaceflight, Roscosmos could really achieve amazing things. On another topic, now that the Arecibo telescope has completely collapsed, as seen on this very sad to watch drone recording here, the National Science Foundation, NSF, and NASA are weighing in on options for a new large radio telescope. Lindley Johnson, director of NASA's Planetary Defense Coordination Office, suggested one possibility for NASA might be cooperation with the military. He said, quote, "We do definitely have an opportunity and an interest in partnering with the US Space Force on a more capable radar system." Now that would really be a very interesting development, because now that Arecibo is no more, the Chinese fast radio telescope is by far the largest radio telescope on the planet.
And just last Saturday, samples of the asteroid Ryugu have safely landed back on Earth. These samples had been collected by the Japanese probe Hayabusa 2 that briefly touched the asteroid twice in February and July 2019. It collected the samples by brushing the surface with its extended collecting arm, the whole sequence being really quite a short encounter. The asteroid is 4.6 billion years old, and we are very curious what secrets the samples will reveal.
On this occasion, we'd like to give a shout out to SpaceX Vision. He makes really excellent Starship animations, which we often use with his permission, of course.
You can find his awesome animations both on YouTube and on Twitter. And please also consider supporting him on Patreon. So thanks for watching the JI Space Report, and I would say, on to the future.